Well, hello and welcome back. This is Doc Martin. I'm the lone journalist for KRAZTV with another great book. I hope the review is as good as the book was. It's called The Wager by David Grann. A tale of shipwreck, mutiny, and murder. It is a book from Doubleday. Yeah. Doubleday. Yes, Doubleday in New York. David Grann is the author of the number one New York Times seller, Killers of the Flower Moon. Gonna have to do a book review on that, right? And The Last City of Z. Killers of the Flower Moon was a finalist for the National Book Award and won the Edgar Allan Poe Award. He is also the author of The White Darkness and the collection The Devil and Sherlock Holmes. Grann's investigative reporting has garnered several honors, including a George Polk Award. He lives with his wife and children in New York. And I was contemplating whether I was even going to do book review, but once I read this and saw the work that David has done, I just had to tell you about it, because we got this book at the Tucson Pima County Public Library. You can get it at yours. Oh, on January 28, 1742, a ramshackle vessel of patched together wood and cloth washed up on the coast of Brazil. Inside were 30 emaciated men, barely alive, and they had an extraordinary tale to tell. They were survival of His Majesty's ship, the Wager, a British vessel that had left England in 1740 on a secret mission during an imperial war with Spain. When the Wager had been chasing a Spanish treasure-filled galleon known as the Prize of All the Oceans, it had wrecked on a desolate island off the coast of Patagonia. The men, after being marooned for months and facing starvation, built the flimsy craft and sailed for more than 100 days, traversing nearly 3,000 miles of storm-wrecked seas. They were greeted as heroes. But then, 6 months later, another even more decrepit craft landed on the coast of Chile. This boat contained just 3 castaways, and they told a very different story. The 30 sailors who had landed in Brazil were not heroes, they were mutineers. The first group responded with countercharges of their own as a tyrannical and murderous senior officer and his henchmen. It became clear that while stranded on the island, the crew had fallen into anarchy with warring factions fighting for domination over the barren wilderness. As accusations of treachery and murder flew, the Admiralty convened a court-martial to determine who was telling the truth. The stakes were life and death for whoever the court found guilty could hang. The Wager is a grand tale of human behavior at the extremes, told by one of our greatest nonfiction writers, Grann's recreation of the hidden world on a British warship rivals the work of Patrick O'Brien. His portrayal of the castaways' desperate straits stands up to the classics of survival, writing such as The Endurance, and his encounter of the court-martial has been the savory of a Scott Turow thriller. As always with Grann's work, the incredible twist of the narrative holds the reader spellbound. Most powerfully unearths the deeper meaning of the events, showing that not only the Wager's captain and the crew who were on trial, it was the very idea of empire. And that is why, once I found out the facts, in 1740, or just a few months before, a war got started with Spain, kind of like the elitists that happened in World War One. They were egging for a fight, and it was the expansionism of colonialism, so they decided to take over some of Spain's possessions and all. Pizarro was one of the captains. He figured largely in this in Spain and in South America, in all the cases. I mean, in all the castaways. So anyways, it was called the War of Jenkins' Ears because this guy named Robert Jenkins had his ear cut off by a Spanish, I guess, captain or noble or whatever. And it enraged, and he kept it in a jar, and he showed the parliament and told them it was outrage and all this. But what I did not know until the very last chapter, that his ear had been cut off 9 years before. It didn't just happen, even though that the British public in England were all misled to think that this just happened, so they got enraged. And so they took advantage of it and started this war. So a very great commodore, he became later an admiral, but he was given command of several ships. And his name was Anson. Now, Anson really figured late. He was a great captain and a commodore, but he also had this guy named Charles Cheap. Now, Cheap was the actual culprit or figure of focus in this story. The book on here is the Centurion. The Wager, I mean. It was called The Wager. It had been name changed and converted from a merchant ship into a small man of war, sixth rate they call it. So anyways, Cheap had always wanted to be a captain, but he was a second in command. But in the flotilla that was heading down to South America and going around the Horn of Cape Horn, they were some of the two ships had to go back, and so he had to double up and change men. Anson did, so he put Cheap in charge of this, the Wager. So he went on. The Centurion, the Gloucester, and all of those ships went on. And they lost each other. And so they said, well, we're going to have a rendezvous somewhere and along the coast there. And he was to meet up and wait 56 days. And if he didn't come by then, well, they'd go back to England or something. So anyway, they were on their way. And they'd made it actually through the hell of the of going around the Horn. They didn't go through the Straits of Magellan. They went around the bottom of it through the 40s and the furious 50s and savage 60s or whatever. Anyways, they wrecked on this little island and they barely made it back, and they got to shore, and the vessel was cracking up and laying on the rocks off of the shore of the island. So they managed to drag a lot of the gear onto the island, and that's where they lived. Then they turned some of the biggest thing that started it all, I guess, is whenever they needed people, they did press gangs. Now, this was before the American Revolution, so they were press ganging anybody. They'd walk into taverns, and if you had on a sailor's hat and tar on your fingers, they were gone, and they picked them up. Then they emptied out the prisons, they took invalids, they just got everybody imaginable that didn't want to go, shoved them on all these ships, and made them serve and man the bilges and all of that to provision out the ship with men. So when they got crashed on this island, some of the more murderous and mutinous people seceded and ran off to the other side. So they set up to the other side of the island, and they didn't have much to eat. They were scrounging, and they were always dying of hunger and stuff. So eventually, they divided in the camp of... He had a guy named Buckley, who was a gunner, and he wasn't supposed to know barely how to write and all that, but he did keep a journal, and he's the one who started writing his journal, and he'd always written a journal. So they got some longboats and cut them down, and they had a few tools, and they had a yawl and a small cutter, and they fashioned some of these boats to take them out, and they were going to go back through where they came from. But this time they had an old book with them and told them to go through the showed them how to get through the Straits of Magellan. So Buckley told the captain, now they left the captain because he'd been gone crazy, and one of the guys, Cozen, was stealing food or something, and he caught him and he shot him in the head with a pistol and killed him. And so that set the other people against him and said, we got to get out of here, we got to go. So they were going to go back to England, and so they loaded 56 guys on one, 25, 30-foot boat, and left him there on the island with a couple of his loyal mates, you know, about six, seven, or eight of them, with Captain Cheap. And they took off, and they went through and got turned around in the Straits of Magellan, but they finally made it out, and people were just dying the whole time. And they were throwing their bodies overboard and stuff. They finally went all the way up the side. They knew they had to get past Argentina because that was a Spanish possession, and they had to get to Brazil. So they actually did make it all the way to Brazil, St. Catherine's Island in Brazil, and then from there they got a ship and went back to England. Well, unbeknownst to them, Cheap had taken some of the other vessels, and he said, well, I'm just going to go on up the coast and get a hold of Anson because I'm supposed to accomplish the mission. So he went north, and they didn't meet up, but he did get captured by the Spanish, and they threw him in prison for a while. I guess they were there a year or something. So in the meantime, Buckley had told this story, and so he just published it and started a book about it and how that they were the only survivors, but he told them that Cheap was still on the island, that he didn't want to go and all of that stuff, which he really didn't, but, well, he didn't want to be with those guys. But anyways, when they got to England, the Admiralty took the story, took the journals, and then they started hacking the story out to the public, and so it became a real rage at the time in 1742 or a little after. In the meantime, after Cheap had been picked up, Anson had gone all the way across the Pacific and landed in Canton, China, and he heard news that that galleon was still there, so he went back to Philippines. It's a fascinating story. It's a true story. And he got the galleon, and he had 32 wagon loads of silver and gold and all that, and he brought it all the way back. Well, in the meantime, Cheap got released, and he got on a ship, and he made his way back. So it was a half a year or so that Buckley was out, and their stories were out, and everybody thought everybody else was dead. Cheap shows up with three guys, and the other people that had been with him all died in their boat. So it's an amazing story. But they got conflicting reports, and so the Admiralty said, we're going to clear this up. So Anson had showed up with the treasure, and he was greeted by the king, and he came back and was given 90,000 pounds of the treasure and tons of gold dust and silver and coins and just you name it. So he really was a hero in all of that. What was amazing is that at the inquest, when it came time and the 13 tribunal judges sat down and interviewed them all, none of them would tell on each other or bring it out. So the Admiralty was really not wanting to bring about big problems. And so they actually found no contest and did not charge Wade Cheap with a crime of murder. And they did not charge Buckley and his crew with the charges of mutiny. So they all went their separate ways. And Anson, in the end, became a vice admiral. And he's the one who actually changed the Admiralty law, or the law of the seas in England, that they no longer did press gangs and all of that. And they wore uniforms. And they figured out how to do vitamin C so they didn't get scurvy, because that was one of their biggest problems. So anyways, I could go on and on, but I'm down here to almost 15 minutes. So get the book. And I just got to say this about David Grann. He went to a lot of trouble and found the original documents and did meticulous research. And he has so many people to thank for. And the institutions in England, like the old Will Courts and the Admiralty Courts and all that, had all this available. And he pieced together this story. But really put the clincher on it that David himself went to the island of Wager Island and found an old piece of the boat still there in the creek. It's an amazing story. Like I said, it's a true story. And it's of intrigue. And, well, it's called The Wager, A Tale of Shipwreck, Mutiny, and Murder by David Grann. Get the book. It was fascinating. Thank you. Goodbye.